indispensable article? An indoor loo? A motor scooter? Or maybe even a washing machine?
A friend of mine, a classmate, Georgina, she was the first one in our class ever to get a thing called a record player, let alone a Dansette.
Yeah, the Dansette.
Well, you think of Dansettes and you think of the Beatles, the Rolling Stones and all these other groups, the Liverpool sound generally. They made each other.
It was the in thing, a Dansette was then.
It's like you'd say a Hoover for a vacuum cleaner. For an old record player, you say a Dansette, and that was the one that everybody remembers as being the one from the period.
Even today, I mean, you say Dansette, they think of record players.
Music and records were an essential part of life in the 50s and 60s for ordinary teenagers, as well as for pop stars like Cliff Richard.
When rock and roll was in its infancy, everybody had a Dansette. I mean, I definitely had one. You know, one of the ones where you put the arm up and you could put a little pile of records on and they just flop down and the whole thing wobbled for a while. And if you were really lucky, it didn't jump in the grooves. So, yeah, I can remember my Dansette with great affection.
We're talking about a time when you didn't have a lot of exposure to music on the radio then, and almost none on television, of course. So you had to buy your own music. You bought a record, and you've got to have a record player. So you bought your records, you went down and spent your 6 and 4 pence, or 4 and 6, or whatever it was then, and hunted out your mate with the Dansette and played them. And played them transparent sometimes. I looked at the little oval thing in the lid of the Dansette, and I knew it. I was intimate with those things. It was part of my growing up.
I'm John Peel, and in case you've never seen one, the Dansette was a record player the size of a small suitcase and fitted with a carrying handle that made it reasonably portable. With a Dansette, a pile of records and a mains outlet, you could have music wherever you went. The Dansette not only seemed to enter everybody's life, it actually helped to shape the music at a time when the record industry was going through its most important phase. Like the miniskirt, the motor scooter and the electric guitar, the Dansette was a symbol of the times.
Jackie's elder brother Dave had left on his Lambretta motor scooter for a day out in Brighton. Jackie had wanted to go too, but Dave said she was too young, being only 15.
More recently, it's even found its way into the textbooks that are used to teach today's school children about life in the 60s.
And smoothed on some white lipstick. The latest number one record was sitting on top of her Dansette. It was Have I the Right? By the Honeycombs.
Although the Dansette hasn't been manufactured for almost 30 years, it still occupies a special place in people's memories. Helen Shapiro.
The first time I went round to my cousin's house, who had one of these, I mean, everybody was very, very excited that she'd got this record player. And she played on it. The first record she played, I remember hearing on this thing, was Calendar Girl by Neil Sedaka. First of all, you just sit watching the thing going round. But then after that, it was really a question of just jive into it and twisting. Those are my memories of very jiveable and danceable records. And again, being very envious of everybody else that had these things, and I didn't have one. When I made my first record, Don't Treat Me Like a Child, I didn't have anything to play it on. And so we had to go around to a neighbour, friend of my mum's, and they had a Dansette. It was such a thrill to hear it on this machine. I wasn't playing somebody else's record. I was playing my record on a Dansette record player. It was like a double thrill for me. It's one of those milestones in one's life as a kid. I mean, what was I? I was 14 years old, very impressionable. And I'll never forget, I sat and played it over and over and over and over and over again. I was so proud of the whole thing and my connection with this sort of famous record player and my record, my firstborn. It was wonderful.
Marty Wilde was a teenager in the 50s and had several major hits in the latter part of the decade and in the early 60s. He too has fond memories of his record player.
The freedom it gave me really was being able to take it into my bedroom, and the bedroom became not only a place to sleep in, it became a place to listen to music. That was one of the first times that ever happened to teenagers.
Young kids, even today, they like to have their own, what we call hardware, you know, their own systems.
It was vital to have your Dansette to take to your room and play against all noise and abuse and broomsticks on the ceiling to tell you to shut up, you know, take that noise off.
I had one in my room. That was where my record player was. We had an old radiogram as well, a blue spot radiogram. But mine was the Damset record player. That was mine.
We'd already got a wind-up His Master's Voice gramophone. Although that was super and it worked very well, there was nothing like having this modern... It was a modern thing to have a record player. Gone were the days of calling everything a gramophone, it was a record player.
You think you remember sort of many a happy hour in your room playing your records on a wet day, and that was... the memories come back with a dancer.
TV downstairs, music upstairs. So it was sort of a young teenager's territory, really.
Remember, if you left the arm off, it would just keep going back and playing the same one over and over again, and which used to annoy the parents, of course.
The Danset was one of the success stories of the 50s and 60s, but the story actually begins at the turn of the century.
I'm Sam Margolin. My grandfather, Maurice Margolin, came over to England from Russia, and he started a small furniture factory. He had 8 children, and most of the boys joined in the family firm. Eventually, the premises in Old Street were purchased, London EC1, and basically the family imported musical instruments from the continent and sold those.
But by the late 20s, the parlour piano was largely being replaced by 2 bits of new technology, records and radio. Many homes had both a gramophone, usually of the wind-up variety, and a wireless set. And one manufacturer introduced a product which combined the two, the radiogram. Here's Gerald Wells of the Vintage Wireless Museum.
By 1924, the HMV company at Hayes produced the world's first radiogram. The needle was on the side of a diaphragm, and you could put it in there and get radio. Or you could use it as a record player.
My sweetheart, you're gorgeous tonight. That's the song I heard on the phonograph. The needle caught on the broken harp and kept playing.
Unfortunately, this was only a prototype. It was never put on the market because the radio was a bit of a failure. And the Frenchman who designed the diaphragm wanted royalties.
Despite these early teething problems, the radiogram caught on in a big way. But it was bulky and expensive. So the Margolin Company combined its interests in music and in cabinet making to produce the Plusogram, a basic turntable which is simply plugged into the back of the wireless set, converting it into a radiogram. Sheila Field is the daughter of one of the company's founding directors, Louis Margolin.
I grew up with the Plusogram. It was always in our home. We always had records in the house. I do remember being told it was the first electric player in the country, and it was the first one ever to be played through a radio, and the Plusogram was part of our life.
The Plusogram was compact and effective and sold well for many years. More importantly, it gave the Margolins a toehold in the record player business, and by the late 40s, they were concentrating almost entirely on the manufacture of this forerunner of the Danset. In America, meanwhile, there was a boom in jukeboxes, pioneered by inventors like Homer C. Capehart of Indiana. He realised that the same technology could also be used to make an automatic gramophone for the home. The Capehart auto-changer appeared in the late 1920s, although its price tag of $1,000 was enough to deter all but the wealthiest customers. Other American companies came up with their own versions, one of which has finished up in Gerald Wells' collection.
The Brunswick Company of America invented the Brunswick Panatrope radiogram. This would take 25 10-inch records. And it would kick the bottom record out, it'd lower it onto the turntable, play it, and the big wheel would come up, spinning it away, shoot it down a chute into this cupboard, where you could sweep out the bits.
These automatic record changers were gradually improved as the years went by, and made cheaper.
I'd like to put on record that I love you, love you, love you. I want the whole wide world to know it's true.
In the early 50s, a company called Birmingham Sound Reproducers, or BSR, introduced a British-made auto-changer at a realistic price. They offered it to the Margolin Company as the basis for a new portable record player. In fact, They even suggested a name for this new machine.
The word Danset was created by BSR. For us. They actually conjured up the name.
And Danset was registered as a trademark in October 1952. That year, the company showed a modest profit of £4,000 and enrolled Sam Margolin as its latest recruit.
Well, I was going to take an engineering degree, and when I was about 20, I went to university. And during my holidays, I was asked by my father, who was the managing director, as he had no salesman and these things were sort of brand new, would I like to try and sell them for the firm? So I took out a sample and did exceptionally well on my holidays. And unfortunately, when my results came through, they weren't very brilliant. I decided to give them the benefit of my experience and stay on as a super salesman. Well, they were very, very easy to sell. By going round all the retailers along the South Coast, I used to take this one record player and a couple of records and go into each curry shop, demonstrate it. Nobody had ever seen one. And they thought it was magic. And they were put in their warehouses and distributed nationally. Obviously, the first model was extremely expensive. I think it was 33 guineas in those days, 1950 approximately, 51. And that would be the equivalent of about £800 today. And, of course, people, well, they were very keen to have some sort of music, particularly portable music, and people seemed to afford them. We don't know how to this day, but they did.
Rock and roll arrived in the mid-50s, introducing a new youth culture. The portable record player was just one element of this.
It marked the end of an era and the beginning of a new era where we, the next generation, had our own piece of equipment, as it were. The gramophone, that big heavy thing in the corner, was our parents. Something from the old-fashioned folks, the old fogies. This was young and with it, and it was our thing. And it also came at a time when, like, the word teenager was up and coming. I mean, we had a name for our particular age group. So we weren't like our parents. It was a breakaway. You didn't have to be subject to the whim of your parents.
And it sort of put you onto the road to changing your image from the sort of, like, pre-war schoolboy look to something a bit more interesting.
I think it was important to have an image when you were that age, you know. So I think, yeah, it's part of being young, you know, having a dance set.
The availability of records and the means to play them changed teenagers' lives. Most young people were quite content just to listen to records. Others liked what they heard and were tempted to have a go themselves. Here's Elton John.
When I was first able to play, I played the Skater's Waltz first, and then I picked up on trying to play the Poor People of Paris and things like that, all the Winifred Atwell things, which used to have records out every week called Let's Have Another Party, Volume 43, which used to hurtle up the charts and used to consist of things like Down at the Old Bull and Bush and various other pop songs. So I used to copy her a lot, and the piano that I played on was very similar to our upright piano anyway. It used to be jangled. I mean, when I think, I sort of used to practice for half an hour, all the classical stuff, and then after half an hour was up, that was it, I was playing other things. And then when I first heard Jerry Lee Lewis and Little Richard, that really was the turning point for me. You know, I didn't really know those styles existed.
Although the Danset's primary purpose was the reproduction of sound, people were also concerned about its appearance. Thanks to Sam Margolin, its styling was improved so that it looked the part as well.
When I first joined, I saw the original samples, and I said, I don't think these are exactly wonderful, but, you know, obviously I'll take them out. And I had a very great hand in designing all the newer ones when obviously they were wanted.
For many years, the electrical industry had divided products into two categories. So-called white goods, like washing machines and refrigerators, that belonged in the kitchen, and brown goods, such as televisions, radios and gramophones, all destined for the living room, or lounge, as we used to say. Well, the Danset changed all that.
It had an American look about it, because it wasn't made of wood, it wasn't made of walnut.
And suddenly Danset come along with blue and white, green and white, turquoise and white. Now it looked pretty tame, then it was outrageous, you know.
Nice cheery bright colours for nice cheery bright kids.
The one I remember most is the one that's on legs, and that really is truly brilliant, with little cocktail legs on it. So that really is evocative of the late 50s, early 60s.
I was in direct touch with all the customers on a day-to-day basis, and if I went somewhere and somebody said to me, well, can we have one in green? I would say, yeah, we'll get you one.
Even the name seemed perfectly chosen.
The name Danset conjured up for everybody what they did, was dance to the music. And you can see them, can't you? You can visualise. youngsters all dancing to their records, and Dansett was the perfect name.
When I was a teenager, the only thing as we had at our youth club was a record player. There was no discos or nothing like that. They used to just have to play it to a record player. That was all, you know.
By the late 50s, it was becoming clear that rock and roll was here to stay. What was less clear was the future of the gramophone record. At first, the 78 disc had been the only commercially available format for recorded music. Yet as long ago as the 1920s, there'd been a demand for a record with longer playing times, mainly for specialised uses, such as in the cinema.
They ended up with a speed of 33 and a third revolutions a minute, way back in the late 1920s, because a reel of film ran for 11 minutes. By that time, it was normal to get 4 minutes on a 78 RPM disc 12 inches across. And if you simply ran the disc at 33 and a third RPM, you could get 11 minutes on it instead. So each reel of film was accompanied by a disc record, which had to rotate at 33 and a third revolutions a minute. I suspect, but I have no proof, that when the American Columbia Company invented what we now call the long playing record in 1948, they picked on 33 and a third RPM simply because they happened to have one of those old turntables lying in the corner of the lab.
Peter Copeland, technical manager of the British Library National Sound Archive. The long player was especially popular with adults. It was ideally suited to classical music, jazz, and material such as musicals, where an entire performance, up to about an hour in length, could be captured on just one disc. Young people, on the other hand, were much more interested in pop songs, usually about 3 minutes long, and with a lifespan of perhaps only a few weeks in the charts. Singles were available in both 78 and 45 formats, and since many teenagers had been given their parents' old wind-up gramophones, the 10-inch 78 was often their preferred choice. But the unbreakable 45 RPM single started to capture an increasingly large share of this youth market.
The 7-inch 45 RPM single was introduced as a rival to the 33 LP, because there was a market for shorter playing times than 25 minutes aside. Obviously, most popular music fits onto that format rather than on a long playing format. And RCA Victor in America invented the 45 RPM disc specifically to cope with this market. So for the first couple of years, they were jockeying for position, but eventually they lived side by side.
So by the mid-50s, records were available in three different speeds, 33, 45 and 78. There were also three different sizes, 7-inch, 10-inch and 12-inch. And to complicate matters still further, a separate stylus or needle had to be used for 78s. For anyone trying to market a record player, the situation was a nightmare. Yet the Dansett and several competing products were sophisticated enough to cope with all of the different formats. As it turned out, the auto-change mechanism alone had over 200 parts. Now, the teenagers of the 50s and 60s were the first to discover that music could be not so much a spare time activity as a way of life.
While getting ready, if I went out to pick up my cousin, we'd listen to records while I'd wait for my cousin to get ready, and we'd go off together to go jiving.
You see the pictures in all the girls' magazines of sort of late 50s and 60s. They've got a Dansett-style record player open on the floor. And then all the other accessories like hair rollers and magazines scattered around. But it's the record player with the lid open on the floor with a pile of records.
Oh, yes, it was forever playing records, getting ready, trying to put on the makeup as subtly as you possibly could so that your father wouldn't notice and tell you to take it all off again. Finding your best shoes out and your best dress. You always had a best dress in those days. And your hairstyle, of course, there was beehives.
My mum said, oh, right, she's not got time for a tea. She'll just be up there now for an hour getting ready. I never used to eat on Fridays, and I used to get in really bad trouble with my father for spending too much time trying to get my hair up too high and not eating my food properly. But I used to get away with it because I was a teenager.
Every spare moment, you'd play records, that in between doing your homework. Or you could actually play your records and do your homework, much to the disgust of your parents, because they thought it wasn't possible to do both and concentrate, but we used to manage it somehow.
In those days, record players weren't exactly cheap, but with the availability of higher purchase, many people were able to buy their first Dansett.
18 quid, I was earning £6 a week, so that's 3 weeks' wages. If you put it into real terms, that's going to come up to hundreds and hundreds of pounds.
That was a bit above my price range then, when you probably only earned about £2 a week when I was a teenager, you know, back in the 50s.
It was a massive commitment. Everybody did it on HP. And somebody that had the Dansett were the king of the area.
And companies like Dansett helped to change the face of the British high street.
When the chains started up after the war, like Broadmead and Stones and Currys and Dixon's, they were looking for product with a margin and we were able to supply it. You must remember that in those days, the people I'm quoting weren't allowed to stock the high-quality Bush, Murphy and sets like that because they had an appointed dealer in each town. Currys or Dixon's or any of the other firms couldn't get them. So we had a whole market to ourselves originally.
Admittedly, some of the longer established record shops were less than enthralled with the Dansett.
We didn't like them at all. They were too cheap, because the type of customer I was supplying would prefer to have a Decca equipment, which was a little bit superior, or even HMV. They were the cheap end. They're durable, and for youngsters.
Teenagers, guys and dolls can be trained in a few weeks to earn £8 or £10 a week. The shops know it, so every town has a store with teenage departments, thriving on giving the young people the fashions they demand, distinctive teenage fashions. The gramophone industry cashes in on the well-off teenagers for some tunes. 80% of the disc output is bought by the youngsters. That's 50 million records a year in Britain alone.
The shift from an adult to a youth market was reflected in the way that record players were sold. Here's Sam Margolin again.
We originally supplied our plusograms. They were sold to furniture shops as a piece of household equipment. But when the record player came along, we sold them to any retail radio shop and obviously gramophone shop in particular, because one went with the other.
What sort of records do you sell most of?
Well, pop singers, 45s mostly.
Would you say that most of your customers are teenagers?
Oh, definitely, yes.
Well, now, if you don't mind, Peggy, I think I'll have just a few words with some of your customers.
Yes, certainly.
Excuse me, sir. Have you bought a record yet this morning?
Well, not this morning. I'm listening to Elvis's new LP.
I see, and I've interrupted you. How old are you?
I'm 17 now.
17. Do you buy mainly pop records?
Yes.
Do you buy any classics at all?
Yes, sometimes I buy some of Frank Sinatra's LPs, but it's not for me, it's for my girl mainly.
How many records have you got at home?
Well, I should say about 300.
300?
Yeah.
Well, I do buy some classics, but not very many.
Oh, yes, I think it's worth it. If you go out to a party, you like to take the records with you.
It was just the thing that everyone had. If it wasn't a Dansett, it was something else, but good 75-80% of what people had were Dansetts.
Life is sweeter with a Dansett. New products for 1962 include the popular, a four-speed record player, plays all records, just £11.10. And for a touch of class, the Bermuda four-speed auto changer. Legs, £2 extra.
And there were some rival products too.
The Radio Packagram. Radio and records off ordinary torch batteries. Not much bigger than a vanity case. Only £22. Easiest of terms.
By piling them high and selling them cheap in our outlets, we managed to keep A, the demand high, and B, the competition out.
Although other manufacturers, I'm quite sure, were attacking this problem from different directions, the Dansett was the first to bring it all together in the same place at the same time.
Every teenage party was fueled by a Dansett, and I don't remember anyone ever saying, turn it up, it's not loud enough. They were always seemed loud enough at the time.
I don't know whether people made less noise then. I don't believe people at parties made less noise than they make nowadays. But you'd get 30 teenagers in a party with a Dansett, and in spite of the roar and shouting of the teenagers, and the Dansett was louder than all that, and it was over the top of all that, and you could hear it, you could dance to it.
We had a party every Saturday night, if we could get a party every Saturday night. Of course, everyone brought their records round, and it was just basically playing records and chatting.
If it was a really good party with a rich girl, only the Dansett, she'd have it on four little spindly legs, and it would take pride of place next to the cocktail cabinet. One of the great charm of the Dansett and the other similar record players is they stacked records. You could put half a dozen or more records onto the spindle and they would drop them in order, and quite often play them in order, but quite often miss one.
As we heard earlier in the programme, the Dansett had been one of the first portable record players, if not the first, to offer this auto-change facility in Britain.
The technology was originally developed for symphonies and music like that when the 78 RPM disc couldn't accommodate a full movement of a symphony without interruption. But of course, the popular music world discovered the advantages of this, particularly in parties and in places where social gatherings were accommodated, and it became quite a practice to pile up as many as eight popular tunes on one record player and let the records drop one after the other to provide a continuous background music.
But there was a drawback.
It was quite normal, in fact, for the very earliest vinyl records on an autochatic changer to drop and then not get up to speed. What with the pickup arm coming down on them and adding some drag, it was quite normal for the bottom disc to go round and round, clinging to the turntable mat, for the disc above it to be stationary, with lots of horrible noises and lots of cursing and swearing from the listeners. So for 45 RPM singles, it then became the practice to have the label raised above the groove surface, so that as the two discs made contact, the groove surfaces weren't in contact at all. And secondly, they added 360, which is the number of degrees in a circle, notches around the label, very, very fine notches, so that the two records would lock together like gear wheels and not slip one on top of the other. And this eventually got written into the British Standards Institution specification of 1955, and from then on, all 45 RPM discs had to have 360 little notches around the edge of the label for that reason.
When Elvis Presley's Jailhouse Rock came out, long queues of teenagers formed outside the record shops. The release date had to be postponed to allow the factory time to catch up with the torrent of advance orders. And in the event, the disc sold 500,000 copies in the first 3 days alone. But Jailhouse Rock was one of the last major hits to be offered in both 78 and 45 formats.
Popular singles, 45 RPM singles, did not really take off until about 1958. Because I think so many teenagers were relying on the clockwork gramophone rather even than the dancette. And it wasn't until about then that the pendulum began to swing in the opposite direction, and people began to buy 45s, which by that time had become standardised, and they could be piled onto the record player and played one after the other, and they would lock together without slipping against each other. Until that was done, it wasn't technically feasible.
Early British rock and roll performers had been heavily influenced by people like Elvis, and much of their material had been cover versions of American hits. Marty Wilde was one of our earliest rock and rollers.
I think that listening to records was the inspiration for all of us, and still is for anybody out there who loves music and wants to be, you know, a pop singer or a singer. To be able to listen to music like that is fundamental, it's essential.
In Liverpool, meanwhile, Paul McCartney was also lapping up the original sound of American R&B.
I remember myself hearing the first Bill Haley record, Rock Around the Clock, and really getting that tingle up the spine I'd heard people in songs talk about. And I finally got it, you know, so I think it was that kind of thing, that we were actually physically being moved by this rock and roll, you know.
Many British musicians, Paul McCartney and John Lennon among them, were self-taught. Since they couldn't read music, it was essential to get hold of the record when learning a new song.
There'd be a legend of a fellow who lived in Kirby. We'll go one day and visit this man. It really was like that. Take endless buses. We must change at Penny Lane. Take the 75C to Broadway.
We did actually make that journey once for Searching by the Coasters. And we tracked that down. Sat in his front parlour all afternoon, just playing Searching. Getting the words, getting the chords, learning how they did it. And that was the first thing. Then the chords was the only other thing you needed. Then you knew the record, so you could tell everyone the chords and stuff. And you could give a pretty good impression of the singer, because you loved him so much. It was Elvis or Little Richard or Jerry Lee. You'd sing it like them. And then after doing that for quite a while, your own voice would emerge. It was just like we'd been cast in the biographies of these people. I was Little Richard. I was generally Elvis, although that could be in contention occasionally. George tended to be Carl Perkins a lot of the time. George could be Carl and Elvis a bit. John was generally Gene Vincent.
Because we had the Gene Vincent album, so we used to do quite a few tracks off that.
After years of listening to American-influenced rock and roll on record, many British performers began to develop their own music. Clem Cattini has probably lost count of the number of records he's played on, but he'll never forget his first ever recording date as drummer with Johnny Kidd and the Pirates.
It was weird to hear it on playing on a record player, you know, as opposed to hearing it in a studio. In actual fact, the funny part about it is, I mean, when I did Shaking All Over, there's a drum thing in the middle of it, and well, you couldn't hear it in them days, but now, when I play it on a high, I'm actually singing while I'm doing the drum break, and you can hear me singing in the background. Obviously, with the old dance set, you couldn't hear it. What I'm saying, the dance set was like a, was an artist's friend, because it did hide a lot of sins.
Fueled by the growing teenage demand for music, the dance set became a best-selling product, surpassing even the wildest dreams of its makers. The Margolin family business became Dance Set Products Limited and was floated on the stock exchange in the early 60s. And the original handful of staff grew to a workforce of several hundred. Nathan Field, company chairman.
It was a family business, and that family extended really to all its employees. The place was small enough to create a very warm, bustling, friendly cooperative atmosphere. The kind is hard to see these days.
I remember my father taking me around. I remember my father speaking, "Hello, Alf, how's your wife today?" and all this. It was always something terribly friendly. It was very exciting as a child to go through there and watch everything being made.
At one time we had people queuing up outside the warehouse, waiting for their orders to be made. More and more outworkers were brought in because we couldn't make every box ourselves. Eventually, the factory manager, Bartrip, had a brother who started his own factory and made boxes for us. So Old Street became an assembly centre. The amplifiers were coming in one delivery. Giant lorries would drive up with 250 or 300 or 500 boxes on, which would be have to be unloaded and taken in to be assembled and so on.
I can remember these boxes being stacked up by the 100 all over the building. The Old Street building was groaning at the joints, really. They had so many record players going through the factory.
Over the period of 10 years, Dansett's profits had risen from a paltry £2,500 to almost £500,000. A staggering sum for 1962. And the biggest ever boost to the company's success was still just around the corner.
The Mersey sound. A sound that means something different from what it did when Liverpool was just an important port. Because now, much to its surprise, the great northern city has got a new industry, as incongruous as the soot on its classical buildings. Liverpool's Cathedral, built painfully slowly through the years, as what? As a mecca for this new generation of long-haired inhabitants, not unconnected with its latest product? Not really. You'll find more of them gathered together in a gramophone record shop.
We were doing this in the 50s, and I think because of the popularity that we managed to put out on our players, people like the Beatles and all their contemporaries were able to sell more and more records, and the more records were sold, the more record players were bought, and so it went on. The teenagers loved the sound and they wanted the Beatles records and everybody else who were around at that time. One worked hand in hand with the other. The more publicity they got, the more sets were wanted, and the teenagers went portable crazy.
And here's top record producer Mickey Most.
I think the dance set was one of those pieces of equipment that once you purchased it, you had to then feed it. So once you had it, you had to keep buying records. There was no point in having Iron Records. So it was that circle that a teenager would have his or her own little machine in his or her bedroom, and they could play their records till the cows come home. If it was on the whole house situation, in other words, it was the family's radiogram, and then you would get complaints, you know, because there was a massive gap between parents and teenagers 30-odd years ago. Oh, turn that rubbish down and turn that music off. But when you had the dance set, which was this portable, small playback machine, in your own room, you could close the doors and you could play the music. Therefore, you needed every Saturday to go to a record store and feed this machine. So you'd go and buy the latest records that you liked, and those days you could buy three for a pound. So it wasn't an expensive operation. And Saturday mornings was the big time in the local record store.
the Beatles records were always cut to be slightly louder than anybody else's when they were played on radio or on the dance set. More people heard them, they came out more.
One of the main reasons for making a record sound louder was so that it would stand out from the rest when it was played among a stack of other discs.
I guess the records were designed to be played on that sort of apparatus. The dance set wasn't designed to play records, the records were designed to be played on the dance set.
To find out how they'd sound in the home, record companies would play their latest releases on an ordinary record player.
We actually had one in our office because we used to play our records on it, and if they didn't jump, then we could pass them, go back to the factory and have them manufactured. Because we used to try and make the records as loud as possible, therefore the grooves would be closer, and when the grooves are closer, you get this risk of the record jumping.
Increasing the volume also had the effect of reducing the playing time. The average length of a 45 single gradually came down from about 3 minutes in the 1950s to around 2 minutes in the Beatle era, with some discs as short as 1.5 minutes. So an automatic record changer became even more essential. But the writing was on the wall for the 2 minute pop single.
The first sort of number one record I was fortunate enough to be involved in was the record by the Animals, House of the Rising Sun. That was a very long record, when records were less than 3 minutes at that particular time. This was like nearly 6 minutes. It was breaking all the rules, and then I had to get 6 minutes into the space that's allowed for 3 minutes without trying to compromise on the level. And that was a battle. We actually used 2, 3, 4 compressors to achieve it, and it worked, because the record doesn't sound quiet, it sounds loud, and yet it is long, which is it's contradictory, really.
The House of the Rising Sun and a number of other innovative releases reversed the trend for very short records. But the dance set company was still on the crest of a wave. As Sam Margolin remembers, business was booming, and they'd moved to a new and much larger factory at Stanmore, Middlesex.
The wood came in on the ground floor. My father, who was the buyer at that time originally, was buying bundles and bundles of wood from Singer Plywood. It would go onto the ground floor and be sawn up. Then they'd be glued with white glue. Then they'd be cleaned up and taken up to the top floor in the giant lift. You'd see a record player box being covered by a team of girls up on the top floor. The smell of the glue, the leatherette coming in from ICI, we were probably one of their biggest customers at that time. It would come down to the second floor. The amplifier would be screwed into the box, and the whole thing assembled and then put on the test line. Of course, we were using hundreds of different records all the time, so the sound was colossal. You could hear this internal jingle going on the whole time, and though everybody was working and fighting to get out the production and working to targets and so on, and it was a very happy time for everybody. And the people there were very, very excited because they knew the product was wonderful. They all wanted to see the finished goods. We were making a lot of money, doing very well, and could see no end to the boom.
Back in the 1960s, it did feel as if business was going to go on forever and ever, getting bigger and bigger and better and better. You get brainwashed in a particular era, particularly in certain trades, that this is just going to go on forever.
Many dance sets were bought as Christmas presents, and a big problem for the company was the seasonal demand.
Trouble was, you see, with a one-product company like dance set was originally, that you were making record players for like 1 week of the year.
So dance set added 2 portable transistor radios to their product range.
Then the company was much more stable because we really majored on radios in the summer, because they were portables for going out with. And we had our backup lines for the winter. And, of course, nowadays, rather like ice cream sells all year round, hi-fi and radio sell all the year round. There's no real season. But in those days, there definitely was a season. People would save up to buy a record player because it was very expensive. I mean, in 1965, for instance, we know that a decent record player was about 29 guineas. And an ordinary, cheaper record player was 18 guineas. So people had to save up. They weren't earning that much, so Christmas was the time, well, we'll save up for a dance set.
Later, the company brought out a car radio, which proved to be a huge success. There was even a battery-powered record player that you could take to the beach, although that was less successful.
The batteries just didn't last long enough. Rather like trying to produce the electric car. It would be ideal if the batteries would last. And batteries were very expensive, but the other point was they were very heavy. So your portability became, you had to be a... And these were selling to children, you know, 15-year-olds even, and they were very heavy, and they just, and you couldn't make it an automatic, it had to be a manual. So it was just one record at the time.
By the late 60s, the days of going into a studio and recording a song in one take were clearly over. Records no longer had a live feel. Instead, producers and artists were making highly creative use of the latest recording techniques. The result was that records were much more sophisticated, and often considerably longer than before. Pop albums had previously just been a bunch of single-length tracks gathered together onto one disc. But records like the Beatles' Sgt. Pepper and Pet Sounds by the Beach Boys were meant as complete works, and made young people turn increasingly to the LP for their music, rather than the single.
If I start a metronome and carry it with me, you'll hear me move from the left-hand side to the right-hand side.
Until the late 60s, stereo had been virtually ignored as far as pop was concerned. But some of the more progressive groups were actually using it to enhance their records. An early concept album by the Moody Blues, Days of Future Past, was specially promoted as having been recorded by the Dynamic Sound System, which, according to the manufacturers, gave a deep, wide spectrum of all-round sound. Where young people would once have been content with a portable record player, now they insisted on a stereo hi-fi system, or one of the new cassette recorders, which were becoming all the rage. The Dansett record player had introduced a whole generation of people to popular music. It had made its debut during the era of the 78, and outlived the various musical fads and fashions of almost two decades. And although the last Dansett was made at the end of the 60s, many people who are fond of old records still prefer its sound.
One of the main ways nowadays people who want to listen to 78s, the best way is to pick up a Dansett record player, because that's the one that has the nostalgia with it. That's the one everybody remembers from their childhood. There's the one record player that brings back the memories.
It was a low-tech sound when it was recorded. It was a low-tech sound when it was played back, but it had some sort of something that matched. Certain records from that era will always sound better on something like that than they do on a hi-fi or a CD.
We recorded everything kind of live, and so it sounded great on something like a Dansett. You put it on to a modern hi-fi and you have to have it digitally remastered and all the rest of it to make it sound good, because it's got all the scratches and the bits and pieces, but perfect for those days.
At home, I've got all the remastered Buddy Holly on CDs because they're convenient to play. But I still got my Dansett, and I go and play Listen to Me on the Dansett, and it leaps out of that little elliptical speaker at the front, and it sounds great.
The Dansett wasn't just a machine for playing records. For many, it'll always be as much a part of the music of the 50s and 60s as the records and the performers themselves.
It just evokes a period and a time and certain types of songs and music.
There was Elvis Presley.
The Drifters.
Cliff Richard came on the scene later on.
Buddy Holly for me was the first records I bought.
Billy Fury.
And then the Beatles, when they first started, very first time in the early 60s, in the Rolling Stones.
Oh, Adam Faith.
I was then, in fact, lent the Dansett on sort of lease loan to use. I had it in my bedroom and I used to play my records on it, and it became part of my culture, not theirs.
And that's how I heard all music up in, well, probably, you know, the late 60s. I certainly remember hearing all the rock and roll, and it, up to Sgt. Pepper, was the first hearing would be on a Dansett.
So what, finally, did happen to Dansett?
The market dried up for record players, basically, and the radios we were making, although they were very nice, the Japs and the Hong Kong boys came over here and lots of people went out to them, and we rather got into a rut, I think, and although we had some very nice designs and so on, the competition was so cutthroat that eventually the firm folded.
I went into the office to see what was happening, and the liquidator and his team of chaps had already arrived. I remember it was like an officer and his troops coming in with a captured city. The liquidator, who was a very bright young man, took over my desk and my office. They stuck me away in a corner somewhere to be questioned, as it were, almost like a prisoner.
My father never got over it. In fact, he'd paced the floor at night thinking, how could we have saved it?
During its years, it must have turned out, I would say, approaching a million record players over the period from 1950 to 1970.
They are an icon of the 50s, 60s.
They just absolutely are. You've seen it on so many album covers, adverts and all the rest. They're very, very simple, electronically speaking. So I don't see any reason why they shouldn't survive another 30 years.
I believe it was the Rolls Royce in the market. Everybody else had Fords and whatever, but the Rolls Royce continues to this day, and the Danset record player will always be thought of as a high quality and a good performer.
I'm John Peel, and in the programme you heard the voices of Paul McCartney, Elton John, Cliff Richard, Marty Wilde, Helen Shapiro, Clem Cattini, Brian Bennett, Mickey Most, Sam Margolin, Nathan and Sheila Field, Peter Copeland, Gerald Wells, David Lashmar, and all the dancers.